Hello, I'm sorry I'm going to speak in English, but if you have any questions in Spanish, that would be even easier for me. I should have done this in Spanish, but I goofed, as we say in English.
Et so moi, je parle pas espagnol.
We're going to discuss about dysautonomia. Do you have the first slide?
Yeah, I'm coming.
Dysautonomia in Ehlers-Danlos. You know, dysautonomia, as you know, is very, very frequent. And most likely, many of you have it and you don't still know it. But it's very frequent in Ehlers-Danlos.
La dysautonomie dans le set est très, très fréquent. Et c'est-à-dire, beaucoup entre vous l'ont déjà, mais vous ne savez pas encore.
There's no disclosure. That's my web page. I always tell people you can read that. You will get more because I have there everything that I know and everything that I have already forgotten.
Sur son page, sur son site web, tout s'est écrit qu'il a jamais su et déjà oublié.
And what is dysautonomia? You see, dysautonomia is that alteration of the autonomic nervous system.
C'est un dysfonctionnement du système nerveux autonome.
It is a condition in which patients tire easily after activity. You know, the important thing about this tiredness, that is not to be tired, is exactly that you lose energy. You can be working or you can be doing sports and you're fine. But the minute you stop doing something, then you feel like you're running out of batteries.
On n'est pas vraiment fatigué, c'est plutôt un manque d'énergie. C'est-à-dire, on peut faire du sport, ça fait rien, mais après le sport, c'est là où on tombe fatigué, mais c'est un manque d'énergie.
Due to this chronic fatigue, an episodic sensation of weakness is that in many cases the wrong diagnosis is made, such as depression, fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue, hypothyroidism or hypoglycemic crisis. This is very frequently an erroneous diagnosis.
C'est pour cette raison qu'il y en a des faux diagnostics de dépression, fatigue, fatigue chronique, hypothyroïde, fibromyalgie, etc.
Family and friends usually see these people as being lazy or unsociable, since they lack energy to participate in social meetings or to interact with other people.
Je peux faire. Souvent considérés par l'entourage comme des gens feignants car la fatigue limite les interactions sociales.
Dysautonomia is a frequent condition that can cause poor quality of life and usually goes undiagnosed. It is particularly frequent in people with EDS. These people may not even know that they have hypermobile joints, and physicians usually pay no attention to this condition and do not make the diagnosis.
La dysautonomie qui est sous-diagnostiquée diminuer la qualité de vie aussi parce qu'ils savent souvent pas qu'ils sont vraiment hypermobiles et qu'ils sont des patients SED.
EDS3 can produce musculoskeletal complaints with joint pain, recurrent tendinitis, joint subluxations and other things, and problems derived from weak tissues like dysautonomia, hernias, varicose veins, uterine and mitral valve prolapse, myopia, spinal diseases, early osteoarthritis and early osteoporosis.
Il y en a de nombreux problèmes dans le SED type 3 qui sont liés à des tissus faibles, notamment les tendinites, les subluxations et luxations, la dysautonomie, les hernies, les varices, utérine et prolapsus mitral, etc.
I usually tell people, and I argue with other friends of mine, which name to give to Ehlers-Danlos hypermobile or to talk about Ehlers-Danlos type 3. My impression is that I rather use Ehlers-Danlos type 3 better than hypermobility type 8, since in my study of 1,751 patients, 55% had a Bayton score of 3 or less, so they were not hypermobile.
Il a mieux nommé le SED de type hypermobile un SED type 3, car dans son étude de 1751 patients, 55% avaient un score de Bayton à 3 sur 9 ou moins.
Which are the symptoms of this autonomy? As you can see here in the slide, chronic fatigue, but it's the chronic fatigue that we have been talking about. It's not just tiredness. And this is usually together with somnolence. People are yawning, they look tired.
Ils sont fatigués, ils ont fatigue chronique, mais ils ont aussi un regard qu'ils ont fatigué.
You may have pre-syncope or syncope. You may have low blood pressure. You may have cold intolerance. And sometimes these patients have poor memory, poor concentration, and disorientation.
Des fois, ils ont des syncopes, une hypotension artérielle, des frilosités, et des fois aussi une mémorisation et concentration qui est très basse.
Why this autonomy is associated with Ehlers-Danlos, and why is it that we rheumatologists are taking care of something that I think should be treated by cardiologists? The reason is that the weak collagen of the venous walls in the lower extremities, that's the reason. In a patient with normal veins, the blood progresses up to the brain, but if the vein dilates due to poor collagen, then the blood pools in the lower extremities and has more difficulty to get back to the heart and brain, causing brain hypoxia, which causes the symptoms of dysautonomia.
Ils se demandent souvent pourquoi ce sont les rheumatologues et pas les cardiologues qui traitent la dysautonomie, au moins en Chili. La dysautonomie est liée à l'hyperperfusion cérébrale parce que le tissu conjonctif dans les veines périphériques n'arrive pas à retransporter le sang vers le haut et alors dans la tête.
Other symptoms: sudden changes such as getting out of bed abruptly, or standing in line, or while walking slowly in malls or supermarkets, or after eating a big meal, especially with alcohol, the blood's return to the heart diminishes, and as a result, the blood pressure drops suddenly and the brain oxygenation decreases.
Souvent un changement de position rapide, alors de se lever ou de marcher très lentement dans un supermarché ou après avoir mangé trop ou bu d'alcool, le sang ne peut plus retourner vers le cœur autant que normalement, et alors la tension artérielle se basse trop rapidement, et alors l'oxygénation dans la tête diminue aussi.
When someone stands up suddenly, 300 or 800 mL of blood stay in the veins of the abdomen or the lower extremities. And in patients with dysautonomia, the body is incapable to compensate rapidly, and symptoms appear like dizziness, headaches, severe fatigue, and even syncope.
Quand on se lève rapidement, 300 à 800 millilitres de sang restent dans les veines de l'abdomen ou des extrémités périphériques. Et dans le SED ou dans le syndrome de dysautonomie, le corps est incapable de compenser.
We're going to go rapidly through this one because I don't even remember it myself. The only causes of dysautonomia that I see really are related to Ehlers-Danlos. I do not see any other cause of dysautonomia, but for completeness, we have this one and the next one.
On va aller très rapide ici parce que lui, il voit pas vraiment la dysautonomie hors du SED, mais pour être précis, il y en a aussi ces autres.
This is an analogy that I like very much, in which the bottle is like a patient with dysautonomia. This is a bottle of wine that is filled only to the middle, and when the bottle or the person stands up rapidly, then the blood stays in the veins of the lower extremities and not much oxygen or blood gets to the brain. And when you lay down of this military guy that falls to the ground, it recuperates because then the blood gets to the brain.
La dysautonomie, c'est comme la bouteille qui a couché où le vin est partout, et quand on se met debout, le vin va au fond de la bouteille et alors on fait une syncope pour que le vin soit également partout.
There are many causes that can aggravate this autonomy, and as you may think, anything that produces dehydration will cause this. So excessive heat, fever, vomiting, diarrhea, some diuretics. Also, you can see people that faint or have problems when they are at high altitude in cities like Mexico or when they are climbing mountains. Standing in church or in line also, or when getting up suddenly from bed in the mornings.
Les facteurs aggravants, c'est la déhydratation de tous les facteurs, trop d'altitude ou d'être debout pour un temps trop prolongé.
Sometimes phobic reactions like to close surroundings like claustrophobia may cause this too. Also the sight of blood, especially if a patient is a relative close friend and then you're sorry about them. Frightening, severe pain or pain associated with anxiety, such as when you're getting an injection, can cause also these reactions.
Des douleurs associées à l'anxiété quand on aura une injection peut donner les réactions de dysautonomie, aussi que la vue du sang, le peur ou la claustrophobie.
Other causes are sexual relations. Probably the blood also migrates to other regions. Menstrual periods, pregnancy, a prolonged hot bath. This is usually seen if people take a very hot, prolonged bath, such as a jacuzzi, for example, or Bikram yoga that is done at 42 degrees centigrade.
Facteur aggravant pourrait être aussi tous les facteurs où le sang va dans une autre partie du corps et y reste, comme les relations sexuelles, les périodes, les grossesses, ou si on prend un bain trop chaud.
Still other causes that would aggravate this autonomia are strong emotions associated with nervousness, as when you're taking an examination, for example, so stress, acute anemia. When everything is being done well, and I always tell my patient, do these five things that I'm going to tell you later, but do them perfectly. If you feel that they have done them perfectly and the result is not good, it's because they have anemia. And remember, vegetarians sometimes are anemic. Also, when walking slowly, like when walking in malls or in supermarkets.
Le stress d'écrire des examens ou de marcher doucement peut aggraver la dysautonomie, aussi que l'anémie. Et là, il va nous en parler après, mais il demande aux patients normalement de faire 5 choses. S'ils arrivent à faire ces 5 choses parfaitement, il n'y a pas d'anémie. Mais s'ils n'y arrivent pas, il pourrait être une anémie. Il faut toujours faire attention aux végétariens qui peuvent être un peu anémiques et qui pourraient aggraver alors la dysautonomie.
Also, with certain blood pressures, especially with diuretics or any blood pressure that can produce orthostatic low blood pressure. I have the impression that many people that have hypertension sometimes have this autonomia also. And probably it's because they're taking too many high blood pressure medicines. So they're over-treating and then they get low blood pressure and they get this autonomia symptoms.
Les médicaments cardiologiques qui pourraient baisser la tension un peu trop peuvent donner la dysautonomie, pas seulement dans les SED, mais aussi dans ceux qui ont une tension artérielle trop haute et qui sont baissés trop par les médicaments cardiologiques.
Also, when standing for too long, maybe you're on a line for too long, or you're waiting or standing but not moving, then also the blood stays in the legs and you get the same problem of low blood pressure. Also after a big meal or alcohol in excess, and sometimes after carbohydrate meals also.
De rester trop longtemps sans bouger, des repas trop copieux et avec trop de carbohydrates.
This slide is very familiar to Dr. Graham. He is the one that did it with Dr. Gacy. They studied many patients, as you can see up there, and divided them in different kinds of orthostatic hypotension, POTS, that is the postural orthostatic tachycardia, and categorized intolerance. This is a very classical study in which they found that this autonomia is part of the extracellular the problems of hypermobility.
La conclusion de toutes ces enquêtes était que la dysautonomie est une manifestation extra-articulaire du syndrome d'hypermobilité articulaire et qui est bien reconnue par le Dr. Graham.
Here's also a summary of that study in which you can see that total dysautonomia in this group of patients was 78%. Imagine how high this is. In my experience is that in females, 80% of females have dysautonomia, and males is almost 50%. So it's amazing the high percentage of people can be suffering of something that most doctors do not make the diagnosis.
Is it with everybody or with an EDS?
With the EDS.
Dans le groupe de 7, au moins 78% en la dysautonomie, c'est un taux très très haut. Lui, il croit que c'est à peu près 80% chez les femmes et à peu près 50% chez les hommes, et tellement mal connu par les médecins.
I think I have that information here. I was getting ahead of myself, but you can see here on the slide that I just said. In the group of patients that were younger than 30 years old, this was 235 patients. So this is very interesting. It's much easier to make the diagnosis in young people, the diagnosis of dysautonomia, than in older people. And the reason is because if you're older, you say, well, I get tired because I am a wife, I have five children, and I have to work a lot, and I am tired. But remember, it's not tiredness, it's lack of energy, and it's different. And here you can see, if you divide the group in 30 year old or under, these are all patients with ES proven by Brighton criteria. And you can see the numbers. And also in this one, I wrote something about osteoporosis, even if we're not discussing this now, because osteoporosis is also tremendously important in Ehlers-Danlos. In males under age 30, it affects almost males and females about the same, about 14 or 15%. So imagine you have a boy that has hypermobile, get a densitometry study, because in 15% of cases he may have osteoporosis. Osteoporosis, we're not talking about osteopenia.
Toutes ces enquêtes étaient faites avec des patients qui étaient diagnostiqués par les critères Brighton. Et la dysautonomie, comme il l'avait dit avant, était à 80% presque des femmes et à 56% des hommes à moins de 30 ans. C'est plus facile de diagnostiquer la dysautonomie chez les patients jeunes, un peu à cause que les plus âgés disent qu'ils sont fatigués, mais il faut toujours savoir que ce n'est pas la fatigue vraiment, c'est un manque d'énergie. L'ostéoporose et pas l'ostéopénie, aussi dans ce âgé moins de 30 ans et à peu près à 14% chez les femmes et les hommes.
Now the treatment of this autonomia. Have you ever noticed it is difficult to make the diagnosis? First, because doctors do not think about this autonomia. Most physicians, I guess here in France also, think that normal pressure is, let's say, 12 over 8. To me, 12 over 8, do you say 12 over 8 or do you say 180?
They say 12 over 8, yeah.
Yeah, 12 over 8 to me in the office is low, because at home they have less. So to me in the office, 12 over 8 is low, and if together with that you have low energy, you're having syncope, and you're having cold intolerance, most likely you have dysautonomia. I do not do much of the tilt test anymore because its risk is expensive and some other problems. But here then, which are the, as I was saying, it's difficult to make the diagnosis and it's very difficult to have a very good result with treatment. I spend hours with the patients. I tell them my own experience because I had this autonomia for 15 years while I was in the United States, and nobody made the diagnosis. So it's not an easy diagnosis to make. So we have general measures for treatment, and we have then the medications. General measures. First, avoid standing or sitting without moving your arms or legs. Avoid walking slowly in malls or supermarkets. When sitting in a bus or an airplane, it is necessary to move the knees and ankles frequently and to get up and walk.
C'est très difficile de faire la diagnose de dysautonomie. Chez lui, il ne prend pas une tension de 12 sur 8 comme une tension normale, parce que ça veut dire qu'à la maison, il sent encore plus basse. Et ça, couplé avec la fatigue, cette tension des syncopes, donne une diagnose de dysautonomie. Il faut y penser. Il ne fait plus le tilt test car c'est trop cher et c'est trop difficile et on n'a pas vraiment besoin. Pour le traitement, on commence avec éviter de rester assis ou debout sans bouger. Et il faut toujours... après avoir mangé beaucoup, s'allonger un peu pendant 15 minutes.
Other recommendations is that we advise people to drink lots of water. And what I tell patients, because it's very difficult, how much water or how much liquid, you must drink as much water as needed that your urine is completely clear. So they have to look at the urine. If the urine is slightly yellow, they need more water, and sometimes some electrolytes.
Il commence à dire qu'il faut boire vraiment beaucoup, c'est-à-dire de boire jusqu'à l'éclaircissement maximal des urines, qui soit blanc. Et toujours, c'est plus facile pour les patients à comprendre.
We also recommend using elastic stockings with a pressure at the ankle of at least 20 millimeters of mercury to increase the blood return from the lower extremities. Tight body garments are very useful, as you know, by Dr. Hamonet, who is probably the main and the most important person in that regard.
Les vêtements de contention qu'on vient de parler, qui viennent d'ici, sont les plus importants, et sinon les chaussettes qu'on met pour les avions, pour les longs voyages, qui compriment.
In the absence of hypertension or kidney damage, I recommend people adding 6 or 9 grams of salt per day. But everybody does it wrong. It's not a matter of adding salt with a shaker. You have to measure 6 grams. I tell them coffee spoons, just level, that is 3 grams. So 2 of them, or sometimes 3 a day. Then this is added to the usual food that they're having at home. So don't change your diet habit at home, but this patient has to add 6 grams every day, but measuring. At the end of the day, he still has something in the shaker, then he has to make a little thing with water and drink it.
Il dit à ses patients de prendre un régime hyper sodé, mais de vraiment mesurer le sel qu'ils prennent. Alors, 2 cuillères de thé ou de café, les petits, ça fait 3 grammes par cuillère, et de vraiment le mesurer et de le mettre en top de l'alimentation normale.
And the other thing is activity. Many, many people have this problem. They may be able to do 4 of the things that we have been talking about, but if they're not active, they don't get good results. And people are usually inactive. Children all day are now playing with the little things, or they are studying and sitting, and they don't move. And so lack of activity is one of the big problems. I always tell them that it's much better to do something like yoga, Pilates, or some other things regularly.
Il faut vraiment faire du sport et de l'activité. C'est même indiqué chez les enfants qui aujourd'hui font des jeux d'ordinateur plutôt qu'être debout. Et c'est du yoga ou quoi que ce soit, mais une activité, du sport régulièrement.
And now regarding medications. We used to use midodrine, that is Gutron, that is increases the blood pressure. But nowadays, because this midodrine only lasts 4 or 5 hours. So if you're going to take this, you have to take it 3 times a day, and it's expensive. So nowadays we're using mainly fluorodrocortisone. In Chile it's called Florinef, and here is Fluorac. Fluritac. And it's a mineral corticoid. It's very difficult for the patients and for the mother and for the relatives to have their children taking a steroid. You have to spend half an hour to tell them that it's not a glucocorticoid, it's a mineral corticoid. The main thing it's going to do is to increase the blood pressure by retaining sodium. It doesn't have the other side effects, but it's really hard. Plus that in Chile is extremely expensive. And so that's another of the problems that we have with treatment.
Ils avaient commencé avec le midodrine, mais c'est très cher et on doit le prendre au moins 3 fois par jour. Alors maintenant, ils donnent le fluorocortisone. Il faut toujours expliquer que c'est un minéralocorticoïde et pas un glucocorticoïde, c'est-à-dire le minéralocorticoïde, il retient le sel et ça augmente seulement la pression et c'est pas une stéroïde.
I have here that atenolol can be added to reduce tachycardia in POTS, but this is something that we're going to have to revise today after the good lecture by your cardiologist. And apparently there's another medication that's much better. What is
Bisoprolol et Carvedilol.
Bisoprolol. I think I'm going to be using that one better.
Il va réviser son atenolol après la lecture de Dr. Amoretti aujourd'hui.
So also, these patients are usually depressed, and it's normal. You go for 10 years or 5 years or 10 years feeling lousy. Everybody thinks you are depressed. Everybody thinks you're lazy. There's no treatment. These patients come to me after seeing 20 doctors and getting all kinds of tests. So you are depressed. You have anxiety, and this, as we know, and Carolina here knows very well that. Anxiety, depression, chronic panic crisis, and phobias are related to EDS also. So this is aggravated by the fact that nobody makes the diagnosis and nobody is treating them well. Sometimes anxiolytics are useful. As I said before, anemia usually is a big cause of a problem and not a good result. Very rarely a pacemaker may be indicated to prevent recurrent syncopal episodes.
L'anémie doit être correctée parce que ça aggrave la dysautonomie. Sinon, on sait bien que les patients SED peuvent être très, très déprimés ou anxieuses. Alors, ils donnent les SSRI normales pour la dépression. Un pacemaker, je ne connais pas le mot en français. On va mettre un pacemaker aussi.
In this picture, some of them were taken from Dr. Graham, nice slides like the old lady and the other Madonna and Lemon, but the one from Marilyn Monroe, I take the credit. I am the only one that thinks that Marilyn Monroe had EDS.
Je dois traduire. Marilyn Monroe, lui, il croit qu'elle aussi avait le SED.
I saw a picture of Marilyn Monroe with a cast on the leg because she was having recurrent torcedura de tobillo, so they say ankle sprains.
Okay. Yeah. Marilyn Monroe avait beaucoup d'entorses apparemment aussi.
Besides other nice things.